We give you honor. We give you all the glory. We give you honor. We give you, we give you all the glory. We give you honor. We give you all the glory. We give you honor. Praise God, praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Unto the Lord be the glory. Great things he has done. Unto the Lord be the glory. Great things he has done. Unto Messiah be the glory. Great things he has done. Unto the Lord be the glory. Great things he has done. Almighty Father, we thank you. King of glory, we bless and praise you. Ancient of this, we exalt and we adore you. We declare your majesty. You are worthy. You are glorious. You are marvelous. You are the King of kings. You are the Lord of lords. Thank you for your grace and your favor. Thank you for your loving kindness. Thank you for your hand of mercy. Blessed, blessed be your holy name. Glory, glory be to your holy name. Father, as we move ahead in the studies of today, Ancient of Days, glorify your holy name, manifest your power. Thank you, O Most High. In Jesus' name, praise God. God bless you. The Most High God be with you. The Most High God make his face to shine upon you. May the Most High God keep you in peace in the mighty name of Jesus. By the special grace of God, we want to begin a new study today. Amen. Praise God. We thank God for what he's been able to teach us from Psalm 110 about the Almighty. But we are going to begin something during the Almighty. During the almost gather on the Almighty, you know, so take note, we are not done and we can never be done with the Almighty. Praise God. But today we start a series and God will have to help us. And it's going to be from the book of Revelations. You know, in the book of Revelations, from Revelations chapter 2, you see a letter written to seven churches. The church in Ephesus, the church in Smyrna, the church in Pergamos, the church in Thyatira, the church in Sardis, the church in Philadelphia, and the church in Laodicea. Praise God. So that will take you us through two chapters in the book of Revelations. Two chapters in the book of Revelation. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. Father, we want to ask that you will help us, you will teach us, and your name will be glorified in Jesus' name. Because today is an introduction, we are looking at the church in Ephesus. Let me just quickly read for you, or tell you a little bit about Ephesus. before we begin to. And it's, don't forget, it's a Bible study. So this is going to be, even the church in Ephesus is going to be very, very in-depth. You know, according to history and theologians, Ephesus then used to be the capital of the proconsular Asia. And then it was in the western part of Asia Minor. Ephesus and Asia Minor was colonized principally from Athens. This was in the time of the Romans. It bore the title of the first and greatest metropolis of Asia. Very developed. The first and greatest metropolis of Asia. Remember, it was a capital of proconsular Asia. You know, the Asia of those days. And it was very much distinguished for the Temple of Diana. There was the chief shrine, you know. It had the shrine of Diana. It had its theater or the amphitheater. At that time, the amphitheater was the largest in the world. It was capable of containing 50,000 spectators. And like all the ancient theaters, you know, it's open to the sky. And there in the amphitheater at that time, it was notable for the fights between man and beasts. That was how they make sports in those days, entertainment. Man fighting against beasts. Wild beasts. And because the Jews were traveling around, many Jews took their residence in this city. And they were sowing the seeds of the gospel, most especially after Pentecost. You know, they scattered. They, you know, Acts chapter 2, verse 9, Acts chapter 6, verse 9, Acts chapter 2, verse 9, Acts chapter 6, verse 9. And Paul the apostle, or formerly Saul of Tarsus, at the close of his second missionary journey, that was around AD 51, when he was returning from Greece to Syria, that was the first time he visited the city. But he was there for only a short time, as he was trying to make sure that he is part of the feast of Pentecost. But he left Priscilla and Aquila. You can see in Acts chapter 18, Acts chapter 19, you see all this there. He left Aquila and Priscilla behind to carry on the work of spreading the gospel. But during his third missionary trip, he stayed in Ephesus, at the upper coast of Ephesus. You see from Acts chapter 19. Actually, let's read Acts chapter 19, verse 1. You know, because I just want you to give us a brief. And I will try my best to see if I can give a brief of each city. You know, and it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples. So you see how we are just putting the story together, you know. And he stayed there for about 3 years. And his exploits, his labors in the ministry were so abundant in Ephesus. You know, that was why he even wrote a letter to the Ephesians, you know. All those that dwelt in Asia they had the word of the Lord Jesus. You know, Acts chapter 19 verse 10 tells us that. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwell in Asia had the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. And I think we can go ahead to the book of Revelations. Actually, let me touch on something. You know, at a time, you know, in Acts chapter 20, you hear the Bible talk about Acts chapter 20 around verse 15, Acts chapter 28, when he touched down in Miletus. You know, Miletus was about 30 miles south of Ephesus. And there in Ephesus, in that region, he met with many people. And you see that even Ephesus wasn't mentioned again until close to the end of Paul's missionary trip. Ephesus was not mentioned again. You know, in his letter to Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 3, he was telling, oh, abide still at Ephesus. And he had some companions there, you know, Trophimus and Tychicus, you know. But let us go. You have a little bit of history knowledge when the Bible begins to talk about Paul's first missionary trip, second missionary trip, third missionary trip. But now let us look at this church that was mentioned, the church in Ephesus. Maybe I should say now that where is Ephesus now? Ephesus is in Turkey. Most of the gospel area now, they are scattered around Turkey. And can you guess that Turkey is now predominantly a Muslim nation? Wow. You know, Ephesus is now a small village in Turkey. In Turkey. And most of the churches in that area. But do you know what? Turkey is now a predominantly Muslim. Maybe we'll be able to talk about the issue of how the gospel changed, you know, and it now became a Muslim something. If we have time to go through that, you know. But let us go. You know, like I said earlier on, I'm just taking you through Bible college. This is real Bible college. I hope you have been taking note of the things that we are learning. So, we want to talk about the church in Ephesus. And our central theme for the church, or the central theme, every letter to the church, to the seven churches, they have a central theme. The central theme for the church in Ephesus is change. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, it says, remember therefore from where you have fallen, return to me and change. King James Version will say, repent. And repent, the Greek word, there are several, about three Greek words that captures repent. But the one that really speaks to it for Christianity is the one that is called metanoia. That is, we change the way we think and we change the way we act. And that is what the God's Word Translation captures it. Reading Revelation chapter 2 verse 5 from the God's Word Translation, it says, remember therefore, remember how far you have fallen. Return to me and change the way you think and act, and do what you did at first. I will come to you and take your lampstand from its place if you don't change. So the central theme is repent. The central theme is metanoia. The central theme is change. So when you look at the advice given to the seven churches, thousands of years ago, and how it affects us today, you will know that it is still apt. constant about God is that God is a God of love. When you look at verse 1, the introduction, he said, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, write these things, said he that holds the seven stars in his right hand. The one that walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. You see God introducing himself as the King of Glory. He introduced himself as the one holding the seven stars and seven golden lampstands. So let's begin to look at the symbolism. Seven. Seven, we know, is the number of perfection or completion. And it's a good thing we are studying this even in the seventh month. So if seven is the number of perfection, the good thing for you, the good thing for me is that God is not a God of abandoned projects. You are not a project that he will abandon. Whatever God has started, because God is the one that started you. According to the book of Jeremiah, before you were formed in the womb, I know you. So you cannot be an abandoned project. When Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, volunteered himself as the sacrificial lamb and the propitiation of sins for everybody, he did not stop until he accomplished the divine assignment. He was able to pronounce, according to John chapter 19, verse 30, John chapter 19, verse 30, that it is finished. So, one thing you should be sure about is that if he has said he will come to your rescue, if he has told you that he is the way, he is the truth, and the life, nothing can hold him back. Praise God. According to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24, the one who called you is completely dependable. I'm reading from the Message translation. If he said it, he'll do it. The one who called you is completely dependable. The King James Version will say, faithful is he that has called you, who also will do it. In Philippians chapter 1 verse 6, Philippians chapter 1 verse 6, the Bible says, I am convinced and sure of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will continue until the day of Jesus Christ. Right up to the time of his return, developing that good work and perfecting and bringing it to full completion in you. Philippians chapter 1 verse 6, the Amplified Version. So you see the seven, the one that has the seven stars and has the seven. So we've just looked at the number seven to talk about perfection and completion. Praise God. So once again, the Almighty God that started a good work in you is faithful to God. There's a song we take from there. We say, he who began a good work in me, he who began a good work in me, is faithful to complete it. He's faithful to complete it. He who started a good work is faithful to complete in me. And I pray and I decree into your destiny that every glorious thing that God has started in your destiny, he will finish it completely. He will finish it faithfully. In the mighty name of Jesus, whatever good thing he has started, he will finish it. Whatever glorious thing he has started, he will finish it. in the mighty name of Jesus. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. So you see something else. Let's look at the ornament. He says, not only does he have seven, he also has something. He also has stars. There is star. See that? Hold it. Seven stars. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. You know, stars, you can call stars heavenly bodies. Or in some other way, you can say star simply means destiny or fortune of an individual. Our star is our destiny, it's our fortune. Praise God. And I decree in your life, your star will shine. Star killers, they will not kill your stars. Glory killers will not kill, because why? He's holding it. Oh, tell me, who can kill your star when the Almighty himself is holding your star? The one that is doing what? That are holding the seven stars. The Bible records, if we take somebody as an example, Jesus, that at the time, some shepherds, they were walking, and all of a sudden they saw the star, and the star happened to be the star of Jesus. As they saw the star, somebody else, one way or the other, also got the news by the name Herod, and he planned to kill the star, but he did not succeed. And I'm telling you, star killers will not succeed in killing your star. Because why? The one that's holding the star. Your destiny is safe and secure in his hands. Your destiny is safe and secure in his hands. Praise God. Besides the star, what else do we have there? This in Satan. He walk in the midst of the, he's not sit, we go there yet. Let's look at gold. 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 Star. Or before we look at gold, let's look at seven stars and what is called lampstands or candlesticks. Praise God. The Bible tells us, you remember in Matthew chapter 5, that you don't light a candle and put it under a bushel. You put it on a lampstand. And lampstands represent what is used to do what? To display. May your destiny be gloriously displayed. May your destiny be what? Gloriously displayed. May your destiny be divinely displayed in the mighty name of Jesus. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. When you look at Ephesians chapter 2 verse 7, you see the kind of divine display. The Bible says that in ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us, through Christ Jesus. That is the kind of display. Display. When you want an ornament or object to properly fulfill its purpose, you place it on the stand. Everybody can see. Multitudes will see your glory. And they will not be able to do anything about it. Because why? You remember, he's carrying the star. But the interesting thing is that he's walking in the midst of the stands to see who will put out the light. Your light will not be extinguished. Your glory, no one will be able to extinguish it. You shall be showcased in the mighty name of Jesus. Because what the Bible says is walking in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. Praise God. He said, he holds the stars in his right hand, who walk in the midst of the, is walking in the midst to see, let us see. He's patrolling. Praise God. If you police, you know how police patrol, you know, they check everywhere. And this, the one that is patrolling, he can see better. He can do better. He's got more power. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. But the thing is that this lampstand is not ordinary lampstand. It is a golden lampstand. And gold represents purity. Gold is durable. And gold is precious. So he's talking to you about purity. He's talking about durability. Praise God. Can I speak to somebody's health? By the mercy of God. Oh, if there is a sickness in your body, the sickness shall be uprooted. Because heaven created you durable. Sickness is an enemy. You are not just created with any material. He said the golden lampstand. Gold is a symbol of durability. Gold is a symbol of purity. And you know, illness, sickness, ailment, disease is an impurity. And the one that is walking in the midst of the golden lampstand will destroy every form of ailment in your body. You know, gold is precious. Praise God. Tell somebody next to you, oh my, I am not cheap. I am not cheap. The Bible says you are bought with a price. It cost the blood of Jesus to purchase you. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. What a mighty God. What a man. Let us read the verse 1 again. Let us read verse 8. Unto the angel of the church in Ephesus. Praise God. The interesting thing is that, because we'll be talking about that in the Almost Gather, I didn't want to touch that. But you have an angel taking care of you. Until the angel of the church in Ephesus write these things. Who said it? The one that is holding the seven stars in his right hand. We are not going with right hand because we just dealt with that, you know. Who walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Praise God. We are just warming up. We are warming up. I'm sure today you learned a little bit about Ephesus. You know that Ephesus now is in present-day Turkey. Turkey is now predominantly a Muslim nation. You know how they got into Turkey. What Turkey was known for at that time, its amphitheater, the Temple of Diana, you know, where they worship idols, the amphitheater, beast fight with men, you know, but with persecution, the Jews, the Christian Jews, they went all over. That is how the gospel got to Ephesus. The first time, Paul wasn't there for a long time, but the next time was there for between 2 to 3 years, you know. And there he wrote a wonderful letter to the people of Ephesus. And John the Beloved is referencing Ephesus now, the church in Ephesus. The theme again for the church is change. We are going to get there. And once again, remember, he is holding the seven stars. This, and he's walking in the midst of the golden lampstand. Not just ordinary lampstand. You are a star and you will shine. You are a star, you will shine. You are a star, you will shine. Your destiny will not be obscure. Your destiny will not be hidden. You will be showcased to the world. In the mighty name of Jesus. For he that started a good thing is faithful to complete it. Seven implies perfection. And heaven will perfect all that concerns your destiny gloriously. In Jesus' name. Let's thank the King of Kings. Lord of Lords, we thank you. Let's even thank him for the fourth day of this year's Almost Gather. Let's give him all the glory for the strength. Let's praise and exalt him. Let's magnify and glorify his holy name. What a beautiful God. What a wonderful God. What a marvelous God. We just praise you. We just magnify you. We just give you all the glory. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. God bless you. Do remember that by the special grace of God, the Almost Gather continues both in-house and online. Like we have mentioned, if you are comfortable to come in-house, you know. If you are comfortable to stay, watch online, that is virtually, that is also great. But as a church, our greatest and utmost concern is your safety. And by the special grace of God, we will also continue to do all that we need to do to make sure that the environment is safe and it is conducive as much as we can do. So God bless you exceedingly. You are appreciated. The Most High God will continue to lift you up and perfect all that concerns you. Remember, tomorrow, 5:30 a.m., Prayer Connect, and Almost Gather is 7 p.m. So there will not be any Bible study at 6 p.m. So take note of that.